Shuklambaradharam Vishnum Shashivarnam Chaturbhujam Prasannavadanam Dhyayet Sarva Vignopashantaye Ramaya Ramabhadraya Ramachandraya Vedase Raghunathaya Nathaya Sitaya Pataye Namaha Om. Dear friends, we are seeing the interesting episode of how Ganga has come down to earth. So, Vishwamitra has been telling the story to Rama and Lakshmana, and we have come to a place where this Sagara, King Sagara, who had 60,000 sons and of course one grandson Amshuman. So, he thought of doing Ashwamedha, and he left a horse, and that horse was followed by this Amshuman, the grandson of Sagara. And it so happened that Indra, he wanted to disturb that particular yajna. Maybe for the reason that ultimately the Ganges has to come down, flow down to earth, etc. Maybe that is, if we want to say justify like that, we can take it like that. So he assumed the shape of a Rakshasa and took away the horse of this yajna horse, kept it somewhere in the nether world. And I was just telling you about the structure, about our understanding of the nether worlds, the Urdhva Loka and Adho Loka, etc. That is a general conception which we find in the Puranas. Of course, we do not find this thing in Upanishads or Vedas. So, anyway, we have come to this place where he steals that yajna. Then what happens? So, if the yajna is broken by any chance, the person that yajamani, the person who is doing that yajna, he will accrue a lot of sin. So, naturally he has to make all efforts in order to trace that horse. So, what he does is, he sends his sons, there are 60,000 sons. Sopadhyaya vachashrutva tasmin sadasi parthivah, that king, shashtim putra sahasrani vakyameta duvachaha. So, he called his 60,000 sons and then said, okay, you please go and then search the whole earth. So, that is what he said, samudra malinim sarvam prithivim anugachhata. You search the whole earth, which is garlanded by the samudra, that is, it is as though samudra is like a sort of garland around the earth. So, dig up the whole earth, not exactly dig up, you search the whole earth, and if necessary dig up, that is what they do. They first search the whole earth and then they again dig the whole earth also. Ekaikam yojanam putraha vistaram abhigachata. All the 60,000 sons, you, each one of you, divide the land among yourselves. It is almost like making some grids, and then 60,000 grids, and then you make it, and then you search all that area. So, that is what they did. Dikshitaha pautra sahitaha sopadhyaya ganastvaham. Okay, I will be here, I will stay here only in this yajna diksha, along with this grandson, which is Amshuman. Amshuman first went, and unfortunately during his time only that yajna, that Indra took away the horse. So, the 60,000 sons are now going, and this grandson is with the Sagara only. And these people, they searched the whole land, they did not find the horse anywhere. And then they started digging up the earth, whether the Ashwa is taken to the Patala Loka. And when they dug up the whole earth, they troubled lot many beings. They troubled lot many beings such as serpents, asuras, rakshasas, Naganam, Vadhyamananam, Asuranancha Raghava. Naga is serpents. Then Asuranam, even the Asuras were troubled, and then Rakshasas, so many people were troubled during that time, and also human beings. Then these people, they excavated the earth, Yojananam Sahasrani, thousands of Yojanas, they dug up. In spite of it, they could not find, and they dug all around the Jambudvipa, filled with mountains, all around this Jambudvipa, they dug up. And then that became a huge, that itself became a huge ocean. So, that is the reason why we call the ocean as Sagara. Sagara means it is something which has been dug by the sons of Sagara. So, that is why it is called Sagara. And all these the gods, Gandharvas and all these people, they got upset. Gandharvas, Asuras, Pannagas, they got upset, and because lot many people were getting killed, they all plead before Brahma. Any problem, all the people go to Brahma. So, the Brahma assures them. We are now coming to the next sarga, that is, Brahma is assuring all these people. Devatanam vachashrutva bhagavan vai pitamaha. So, that 40th sarga, it starts like that. So, he heard all their grievances, and he said, don't worry. So, these people, because they will go and finally they will offend every great sage. And then that great sage will be so much enraged that he will turn them into ashes. So, don't worry. So, kapilam rupam asthaya dharayat yanisham dharam. So, this is again one say particular belief according to Puranas. But again Vedas do not say, Upanishads do not say, but this is again a Puranic thing. So, here SAM Vasudha Krishna Vasudevasya Dhimataha Mahishi Madhavasyesha Sayeva Bhagavan Prabhu. See, he says, he talks about what is called Ashtadiggajas. Ashtadiggajas means not our Krishna Devaraya and Diggajas. The whole earth is supposed to be say held up by eight huge elephants, mighty elephants. So, that is, we talk about the eight sides, north, east, west, north, south, and apart from that there are other north, east, south, west, etc. All together eight. It is assumed that there are eight huge elephants which are holding this up, earth up, and below that they are all again supported by the yogic powers of one particular rishi called Kapila Maharshi. So, and that Kapila Maharshi is also said to be an avatar of Vishnu. Kapila Maharshi's avatar is described more in Srimad Bhagavatam. There is what is called Kapila Upakhyana. There Kapila, how Kapila tells Atmajnanam to his mother, what is her name is Devahuti. So, Kapila Devahuti Samvada, etc. They are very famous passages in Srimad Bhagavatam. So, Kapila is a very renowned sage, and he is said to be an avatar of Vishnu himself. There is another Kapila who is responsible for the Sankhya Shastra. So, this Sankhya Shastra, of course, Sankhya Shastra, even now it is available. Sankhya, it is something which is somewhat slightly distinct from Vedanta, but then Vedanta has borrowed lot many points from this Sankhya Shastra. And if you see Gita and if you see Upanishads, etc., there we come across how the sage Vyasa himself has borrowed or rather accepted some of these ideas from the Sankhya Shastra. So, Vedanta talks about one supreme reality called Brahman, and then that Brahman with the there is a manifesting power called Maya in that Brahman, etc. That is what we see. This Sankhya accepts two principles, that is, one is insentient and one is sentient. That sentient thing is called Purusha and the insentient thing is what is called Prakriti. Whereas, Vedanta talks only about one principle. Sage Vyasa accepted a little bit of these things, because from this insentient Prakriti, there are three aspects in that Prakriti, or three components of that Prakriti, that is called Sattva, Rajas and Tamoguna. So, this ideas of Sattva, Rajas and Tamoguna, they were actually accepted by Sage Vyasa. And if we see Sage Vyasa, he was a very great reformer. He was a very great Samanvayakarta, we can say. A person who harmonized so many things. So, he took the Upanishads on one side, and then he also introduced this idea of Sattva, Rajas, Tamoguna, and then here we find in Mahabharata, Chaturvarnyam, Maya, Sushtam, etc. So, that sort of harmonization and that sort of Samanvaya was done by Sage Vyasa. So, we have to see, we do not know exactly whether our ancients, they referred to the same Kapila, or whether it is some other different Kapila, because generally in our tradition or in any tradition what we see is, when there is a very great person, we immediately call him the avatar of Vishnu. So, maybe we do not know whether he is the same Kapila who wrote this, who is responsible for Sankhya Shastra, or whether he is a totally different person. The traditional scholars, they say that he is a totally different person. Generally according to our tradition, they say he is a totally different person. Brahma assures them, okay, these people, they are going to offend that particular Kapila, and Kapila Maharshi with his great power, he will turn them into ashes. So, that is what happens. And after listening to that, Pitamaha Vachashrutva Trayastrimshadarindamaha Deva Parama Samhrushtaha Punar Jagmur Yathagatam. Here there is another word here. Pitamaha Vachashrutva, after listening to this Pitamaha means Brahma, these 33 gods, they were very happy and then they went away. So, who are these 33 gods? Again, this is another point which is normally talked about in our tradition. we usually hear certain allegations. Oh, you Hindus, you have got 33 crore gods. What is this 33 crore gods and where is this number coming? So, here also in this 40th Sarga, Shloka number 5. So, it talks about Trayastrimshadarindamaha. Trayastrimshad means 33. So, who are these 33? So, this is what we have to see. You see, if you observe this, the whole universe, there are certain things which are favorable to the existence of man, which are nourishing, which actually nourish the human being. There are certain beings which, there are certain things which cause rather anxiety and then which cause some trouble. And then there are certain other things which also are related to intelligence. So, it is like that. So, the things, the aspects of nature which nourish, they are called the vasu. Vasu means vasati. Vasati means to stay, to live. Vasu means to live. So, that which enables you to live strongly, enables to be maybe happy. So, they are called the vasus. Rudra. Rudra is rodayati. Those elements in the prakriti which make you cry, they are called the rudras. And then Aditya. Aditya is something related to intelligence. So, Vasu, Rudra and Aditya. Vasus are 8. Rudras are Ekadasha Rudra, that is 11. Dvadasha Aditya, that is 12 are Adityas related to intelligence. So, these put together they come to say 31. And then Indra and Prajapati, all those two also are added. So, these three become, all these become 33 gods or 33 category of gods. So, these 33 also, that is only a particular name is given, and then under that there are many other categories. So, that, so if you say 33 categories or 33 types of divine beings we find in the universe. So, 33 types of divine forces, let us say, not beings. When we say being, we immediately think of a person. We think of somebody with a body, with a head, hand, shoulders, etc. Not like that. 33 different forces which are called these deities. So, these people, they are very happy. In fact, if we want to know about this 33 gods, etc., 33 crore gods, etc., we have to see one Upanishad called Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. In that Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, there is a particular passage called Shakalya Brahmanam. So, Shakalya is the name of a sage, he is also a sage who has a discussion with Yajnavalkya. Yajnavalkya is one of our great sages. Yajnavalkya is one of the greatest rishis, say, who has given several Veda mantras. So, this Shakalya has an argument with that Yajnavalkya, and in that argument, Yajnavalkya explains to him what exactly are 33. So, that is what there you come across this whole discussion. What is the meaning of 33? So, that we have to see. So, okay, fine. Thereafter, all the gods, they were happy and then went away. So, come, we will come back to the story. So, what happens to this, say, 60,000 people? Tato bhitva mahim sarvam. They broke the entire earth. Bhitva, they broke the entire earth. So, parikranta mahi sarva sattvavantascha suditaha. So, they just went all around, say, the world, and then they killed several people. Sattvavantascha, any strong fellow appearing, they just kill them also. Deva Danava Rakshamsi Pichasha Pichasha Uraga Pannagaha. So, they just whoever resisted them, they killed them. So, then they again went back. They went back and then told their father. You see, we searched the whole earth, and then in fact we eliminated lot many people also, but still we are not able to find the horse. So, the father, he is not very happy. So, he says, go do it again, he says. So, he is a very tough boss. Bhuyah khanata bhadram vo. Bhuyah khanata. Bhuyah means again you go and dig. Bibhedne, vibhedya vasudhatalam. Okay, you also go to the patala loka also, right down, you go there. Okay, these people, they have no other option, and then they go. When they go, we now come across what is the concept of diggaja, that is the elephants which I was talking about. So, these elephants, they just see one particular, they go to one particular corner, they see an elephant, and that is, and there again lot many sages, etc., they are worshipping those elephants. These Sagara's sons, 60,000 sons also, they are not by nature bad people. They are also very well trained people, good people. So, intrinsically they are not bad. So, they also respect this, they also touch that horse and that elephant, they circumambulate it, pradakshinam kurtva. So, tetam pradakshinam kurtva dishapalam mahagajam. They also did pradakshina because it is the duty. It is also the duty of people to do that pradakshina. So, they did pradakshina, and they went ahead. They went to another quarter. They went to another quarter. They also did pradakshina of that diggaja. So similarly, they did all that. And after all that, so they came to one particular place where this Kapila Maharshi was doing tapas. What happened was, Dadrushuh Kapilam Tatra Vasudevam Sanatanam. They saw this Kapila Maharshi who was doing tapas there. And it so happened that this horse which was stolen by Indra was also there somewhere nearby. So they immediately jumped to a conclusion. So this is the fellow who has stolen the horse. So they just they were enraged, and then Kanitra Langaladhara, they took all types of implements which they had. They were not exactly weapons. Kanitra means the digging implements. Langala is something which you call a furrow. The farmers, they use to plow the land, plow. So this digging instruments, plows, etc., whatever instruments they had, they just rushed on him to thrash him. So at that time, when they were about to thrash him, this man, he gave a hunkara. Rosheṇa mahatā viṣṭo hunkāra makarottada. Hunkāra. So we have come across this word hunkāra in Vishwamitra's episode also. When Tataka was pouncing on them, when Tataka was about to fall on them, Vishwamitra did hunkāra and then stopped that Tataka. It's basically a sort of yogic power which resists. So by that yogic power, so he did a hunkāra, and then with that yogic power, with all these 60,000 people, they were turned into ashes. So this is what happens. So then what happens? This chap, King Sagara, is we now come to the next sarga, called sarga, that is 41st sarga. King Sagara is waiting for his sons for a long time, absolutely no news about his sons. Then he sends his grandson also, okay, you go in the same path, you travel in the same, go in the same path, try to find out what happened to your uncles. So this man again, he goes. And then Amshuman is a more gentle and more courteous, more refined person. So abhivadya abhivadyanstvam hatva vignakaranapi siddhartha sannivartasva. So that is what the grandfather is saying. Respect all elders, abhivadya abhivadyan, that is the people who deserve respect, you please give respect, proper respect. Hatva vignakaranapi, those who resist, you can kill them. Siddhartha sannivartasva, you come back achieving the task. So that is what he says. Then Amshuman also say he follows the same path, and he also goes down and then sees those mighty elephants, Diggajas. He also goes around them and then he worships them. Then the Diggajas are pleased. This chap, he also questions them. He also questions them as to what happened and all that. So Diggajas, they direct him, okay, you go to that place where these people are turned into ashes. So he goes there, and then he sees all the uncles who are there in a heap of ashes. So bhasma rashi kruta yatra pitarastasya sagarah. Bhasma rashi means a huge heap of ashes. So that is what he sees there, and he was very much very unhappy. Chukrosha paramarthastu, he cried out, and there was no other he could not do anything else. What to do? And when he sees the people who are turned into ashes, his first duty was he has to do some tarpanam, because that is what we came across earlier also, jala tarpanam. When all these rishis, they came to Ganges, the first thing they did was to do pitru tarpanam. So this pitru tarpanam is one particular norm or particular value which is being established by Valmiki here. Because this Pitru Tarpanam is something which is there continuing even now. Lot many people even today, some people they do every day, most of the people they do on Amavasya at least. So I have come away, we see lot many people doing this Pitru Tarpana and this Amavasyas. So this is something which is there even today. So Pitru Tarpanam is you recall the names of all the relatives, dead relatives, grandfather, great-grandfather and his father, etc., at least three generations, and then you recall all the names, and then you offer some tarpana, offer some waters along with some til. So that is what is tarpana. And there is a small procedure. All that takes about 10-15 minutes. So anyway, this Valmiki is actually establishing a particular norm, And why is this so? Pitru Tarpanam. Is it because these people are somewhere languishing in hell or something like that? And unless you give waters, these people will not be raised to heaven. Is it like that? Of course, Puranas say like that. But if we see logically, this is basically to continue dharma. You see, your great grandfather followed a particular dharma, and his father also followed a particular dharma. So you are thinking about what exactly is this great line? What is the intellectual heritage which these people have passed on to me? So that intellectual heritage has to be kept up. So that is the point which you have to bear in mind. It is not as though you give some salilam, that is water, and then these people are raised to heaven, etc. The idea is that you have to recall that particular dharma which your great grandparents followed, and then you have to continue that dharma. So that is what we have to see here. So Valmiki is establishing such practice here. Then, so he did not know what to do. He did not find water anywhere in that patala. At that particular place, there are only heaps of ashes, and he did not know what to do. At that time, he saw Garuda. He just saw who are all there, and then he saw Garuda. And he bowed to Garuda. He respectfully bowed to him and requested him, "What can I do now?" And Garuda, he advised him, or he told, what all has happened, it has happened for the good of mankind. So he says, Sachainam abravid vakyam vainateyo mahabalaha. So vainateya is Garuda. He says, Mashuchaha. Mashuchaha means don't worry, Purushavyagra, oh my dear person. Vadhoyam lokasammataha. This vadha is lokasammata. Lokasammata means this is something for the welfare of the people only. This is something for the good of the people, he says. Why? That is because Ganga is going to be released on earth, and then from earth it will come down to here, this place. So it is for the good of mankind. So that from that point of view, he said. And Kapilena aprameyena dagdhahime mahabalaha. All these people, they have been burnt to ashes by Kapila. And Kapila is a very great person. And when Kapila has turned them into ashes, ordinary water cannot restore them to heaven. So when something happens, when a person dies a normal death, so maybe ordinary water will be able to it is good enough for Pitru Tarpana. But they offended a great sage called Kapila, and that great sage himself has turned them to ashes. So the only water which can raise them to heaven is Ganga. There is no other water which is equal to that, and if only you get Ganga, then only all these people will be raised to heaven, he says. Salilam narhasi prajna datumesham hi laukikam. So, this laukikam salilam, that is, laukikam means earthly. Whatever water you find on earth, this earthly water is not enough. You have to get some heavenly water in order to raise them heaven, because the person who gave the curse is a very, very strong, great man. So, if that has to be, if that has to be neutralized, or if something good has to be done, so only Ganges has to come. So, that is the point. So, we will continue in the next episode. Harihi Om Tat Sat.